Hello there, praise the Lord and a warm welcome to one and all of you. And greetings to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hope you're all doing great, and even if otherwise, please do not lose heart. This is what we keep reminding you in every session, because all of us have some of the problems in our lives, and life is full of uncertainties, things that you cannot even predict, things you cannot foresee in advance. And it doesn't stop there, right? There are troubles that you will need to overcome to prove that you're having faith in God. To prove your faith, you will have to fight battles. And how to fight battles, with what to fight battles, all these things we covered in multiple sessions. It's available in our playlist, Know Your Enemy. We have done a beautiful study from Ephesians 6 verses 9 to 17. It's how to use those six weapons and to fight against the wiles of the devil, the principalities and the powers of darknesses. He's an unseen enemy, right? He's an unseen enemy, but not an unknown enemy. This is exactly what we have described in that series. Right? How many of you have witnessed, I can see devil in me. Devil manifestations you might have seen. When the demons enter into a person's body, you can of course witness in multiple places, maybe in your street. From my childhood, I witnessed this through from multiple people, through multiple people belonging to other religion, belonging to Christianity also. Right? And as I grew up, I didn't know the word of God. Therefore, I was thinking demonic manifestation simply means biting the tongue and pulling the tongue out, and the hair will be scattered, and eyes will be almost buckled out. And this is called as demonic manifestation. Then I understood over a period of time after starting to read the Bible that this is less than 1% of people that whom you could witness that these are their deeds, right? Can you just check around your neighborhood? Show me one person who's having this problem. Maybe one or two, whom you may not even know. But when you walk across the streets, you go to a workplace, you drive, and you end up meeting so many pedestrians and crossing so many pedestrians, bikers, motorists, and so many other people. You don't see any of these? That's where the devil, fools the mankind, making us more complacent, making us walk in presumption that the definitions of the demonic manifestation is equal to demons living in a person's body. No, that's not the truth. 99% of the world belongs to the devil. World means what? People in the world, right? But you will see barely among this 99%, 0.1%, 0.2% of people, pulling out their tongue out and something like that, looking at you with the scary face and all that. Barely you can see. But the remaining 99% are demon possessed. How? Through their habitual practices, through their lifestyle, through their attitude, through their behavioral pattern. That's why we keep telling you. They can read Colossians 3, 12 to 25 and Ephesians 4, 17 to 24 and Romans 12, 12 to 21 and Ephesians chapter 5 and 1 John chapter 2. Make a note of this. Until you comment in that comment box, I'm not going to leave you in peace. Why? Because I want you to know whether you are demon possessed or not. Oh, in that 99%, yeah, a lot of Christians are also there. Sorry to say this. Nominal Christians, traditional Christians, Orthodox Christians, Pentecost Christians, this Christian, that Christian, everyone. There are how many congregations are there? Hundreds of congregations are there, right? Within this Christianity as a denomination. Huh? Some tightly practice ecumenicalism. Some tightly get some tightly embrace the denominationalism and traditionalism and fundamentalism and so many syncretism and so many isms are there, right? Each one practice their own theory. And who are they? They're demon possessed. Because anyone, simple theory I'll tell you, simple definition of demonic possession. If you're demon possessed, how can I identify? Can you please describe in short tense? Anything and everything that you practice, that you believe, that you do are not in the Bible simply means it is of the devil. Even this is longer. No, I'll tell you in very simple terms. Every action, every word of your mouth, everything that you believe, every choice you make, every decision you make, you got to compare it to the Bible. If it is in the Bible, it's of the Holy Spirit. If it is not of the Bible, it is not of the Holy Spirit. It is not of God. It is of the devil. Simple. And that's why Bible strongly encourages each one of us to introspect every single day. Introspection must be part of your DNA. Like how you wake up, brush your teeth. Hope all of you brush your teeth, right? Once in a week at least. There are someone called us, I mean, one group called us hippies. You can see them in US. You know, they don't do any of this. They don't take bath. They don't brush their teeth, and they don't even change their dresses or inverse. They just walk around like animals. Hope you're not one of those. Clearly, they are demon possessed. Bible also teaches a lot about cleanliness. Take it, the book of Leviticus, Numbers. You will find, you know, how you even touch a thing that is dead or something like that, and how you need to cleanse your externals. Bible is not only talking about internals. Old covenant is more of externals cleansing, external cleansing, which is needed. Cleanliness is important. Therefore, you could live healthy. Hygienic life is important. And God taught us a lot, even what to eat, what food not to eat. Why? Because it is going to harm you. You keep eating, frying cockroaches and keep eating, you will end up with some flu, which even the doctors could not diagnose, and no medicines to heal you, and forget it. You will be dead and gone. Why? Because they carry all the deadly virus. Cockroaches are everywhere in the septic tank. You're all wondering who is eating cockroaches. Go to Japan, Singapore, China and all that. It's common. Not only that, they eat even centipede, millipede, all the things. They have not spared anything. Diseases are going to be spread. Swine, you know. Pig. You cannot eat pig according to the Bible. Why? Pig is an animal which has been created to clean the dirt of the world. To bring cleanliness on earth. Whatever dirt it consumes, it gets into your body, and that's why you get swine flu. And you gladly pass that flu to other people. You ate pig. Why I should suffer like a pig? Tell me. You ate pig, therefore you become a pig. You know, why should I suffer? But this is how the world is, completely contaminated through their behavioral patterns and through their lifestyle and habitual practices and whatnot. And that's why Bible talks about both external cleanliness and also the cleanliness inside. New covenant, Jesus came to emphasize more on, you know, inside the cleanliness that must happen right inside your heart, because enough of those laws are given in that first 39 books. So Jesus didn't want to waste his time repeating the same thing which his father told. You know, who is his father? He is that father. He is the son. He is God. But then he took that in, you know, appearance as flesh and blood and came as incarnate deity. Nobody could kill him. He you know, the Holy Spirit rose up his body. The Spirit of God descends on him and he rose up on the third day. Who can kill God? No one can kill God. But then why 3 days he was there? Immediately after he was dead, and he has to die and he has to go to Sheol to perform certain activities. And then he comes finishing those duties. And all this I covered in the body, spirit, mind and soul. Spiritual composition of human heart. In that series I have covered. You know, for everything there is a reason, there is a purpose. Bible is not a book that is so blunt and blind and you can assume anything and everything you want. This is how Christendom is functioning. That's why you got to get into conversation, realistic conversations, a channel like this where we teach and preach from the Bible as according to the revelation of the Holy Spirit, as inspired by the Holy Spirit, and we confirm it always from the Bible. Always we start from the Bible and we end in the Bible. In between also we speak from the Bible. Nothing outside the Bible. You all understand? Okay. Warm welcome to this episode number 2, where we are dealing through this important subject. Very important subject, right? How important it is. We have split into 5 episodes. Episode 1, we studied on eschatology. It's already in your playlist. You know, we have released almost 110 videos only on that. 7 events that happens immediately after the second coming of Jesus. Episode 2, right now, what we are dealing is a very, it's going to be a very long series. I can guarantee that. You know, already 200 plus sessions, and we are on the fifth event. Jesus left behind 14 events as evidences that when all of these are fulfilled, you will know my second coming is not going to be delayed. It's not too far away, which also means the great tribulation period is also not too far away. Ah, what is this? You spoke about second coming and all of a sudden you are switching gears to great tribulation and you are saying second coming happens after great tribulation. True? Yes, it is true. I have proved it from the Bible. Beginning of this series only, I have proved it. Episode 2. It's there. Matthew 24 verses 15 onwards. You read, you will understand. You don't understand? Listen to our sessions. You will understand. That's why we are here to explain and help you, right? Episode 3 is pipelined to talk only about the great tribulation as a topic. What it means. What does it actually mean? Revelation 8 and 9 has been coupled into episode number 4, where we are going to talk about the six trumpets which are associated. Right? Episode number 5, we want to talk about Armageddon battle. What exactly happens there? Revelation 19, 20, we will be focusing. Five series ahead, three ahead of you, one finished, and right now you are in the second episode. Right, all of these connecting to just one terminology, second coming of Jesus. And you all need to focus on this. Actually, my agenda without these five series is full for the next 5 to 10 years. So much I have to preach and teach. But God spoke to my heart, telling me very clearly, the priority for your ministry is second coming. Finish that and then continue with everything else that I've given you. I'm changing the priority. I said, okay, Lord, let me begin this. I thought I will finish in maybe a few sessions, my 50, 60 sessions, like a Bible teaching and all that. And then when the Holy Spirit began this second coming session through me, I didn't have idea that it is going to get so long, so far, even to the extent of 5 episodes. For now, it's 5 episodes. It can become even 10 episodes. What I'm trying to tell you is, beloved, your time on earth is actually numbered. Your days are numbered. The hours and the minutes and the seconds and the everything that you're, you know, spending, your time on earth is really limited in that short span of life. Don't waste your time fighting with human beings, getting angry, emotional outbursts, and getting into depression, frustrations, disappointment, too much into materialism. Oh, my money, my bank balance, and my investments, my savings, and my dogs and pussycats, and you know, please. At the same time, I also want to remind you that earthly duties and responsibilities are important. You cannot compromise. There is no two ways about it. But at the same time, what is also important is you need to understand that your spiritual duties and responsibilities are eternal. Earthly duties and responsibilities will stop at a certain point of time. Why? Because the next generation will rise up. Your daughter, your son, your children will start going to work and they know how to take care of themselves. You don't have to press hard after that. Which means what? What are you doing after that? See, these days people are very good at planning. I hope so. I believe so. Especially Christians listening to me, don't keep telling, I don't have money to pay my rent. You should have your own facility. You should have your own house. Yes, that's a blessing of God. I believe in blessing of God. Leviticus Leviticus 16 and Deuteronomy 28. I am a strong believer of this. You know, blessing and curses. If you don't, not Leviticus 20, say 16, Leviticus 26, I think. Correct? Yes, it is. Leviticus 26 and Deuteronomy 28, I believe. Blessings and curses. Or blessing and retribution. If you fall in line with the laws and commandments, blessed are you. And it is true. It is valid even to this day. And Jesus also reassured, all that you need on earth, your heavenly Father will already know and he will provision it, whether you ask or not. But when you ask, he is more willing to give. I mean, he's more, not more willing, more pleased to give, right? It really pleases him. And my little child is asking for a bicycle. Okay, let me give. You understand, huh? So no, nothing wrong. But then that's all going to stop at some point. You know, you're not going to run after materialism for another 100 years. Say you are living for 100 years. You'll be after materialism maybe to the age of 40, 45. And you are going to be settled. All that you need, God is going to provision. And after that, at least you could start focusing on God's work, spiritual duties and responsibilities that you have on earth. First of all, you need to qualify. Yeah, I spoke about the qualification of when a Christian is qualified to be called as a Christian. It's there. Yesterday I was preaching is one of the short sessions. Where is it? Qualification of, yes, here it is. 1 Timothy 3, 1 to 7. Qualification of overseer. Overseer means what? Not only a supervisor. Every Christian disciple is an overseer. You have been appointed to take care of the earth. The earth that is getting towards destruction. Whose duty? Whose responsibility it is to save this world? My duty and your duty. We are those overseers. And what qualifies to get you there is what I have explained from the Bible yesterday in one of the short sessions. But let's see if I can preach and teach sometime. So right now we are in the fifth event. Now coming to episode number 2. And we are dealing through this very important subject of rise of a power that mixed with aggression and fundamentalism. Aggression, we discussed a lot. If you have not gone through all the 50 to 60 hours of teaching on aggression, I recommend, I please enforce, I insist, kindly go there, finish that and come. Otherwise, you won't understand. Because fundamentalism is married to aggression. Aggression is evolved from fundamentalism, which I'm explaining now, but it's like a bottom-top approach. You need to understand the consequences. You need to understand the post-consequences, the implications, the repercussion. If you are on the negative side of fundamentalism, that is destructive side of fundamentalism. And if you are on the positive side of fundamentalism, what will be the repercussion? We have explained that in aggression, positive and passive aggression, we have described, right? Fundamentalism is nothing but a belief that you are really biased, that you are carried away, that you are attached, that you adhere, that you abide, that you believe. A certain belief. That's why you see this world is divided based on their belief that they have. They believe on certain things. You talk to an hijacker, he believes what I do is right for my religion or for my nation or for my community or my caste or whatever gender or anything. You talk to a person who is a gay, he believes being a gay is the right thing to do. Yeah, all this law of nature and all these things are something that you people are believing. That's the only method to beget a child. See, we have invented test tube babies now. What a capsule baby. There is a capsule in which you can also grow a baby. Who said we cannot have a kid? We both are married. Male and male marrying and begetting a kid. Can you imagine? Yeah, but they believe. They're very serious about that. That's why the government of India passed a law saying that gays are recognized in the society. You can feel proud who you are. Feel proud and go to hell. What else? Oh, you are abusing and condemning us? Yes, not condemning according to the law of your land. The law of the land will perish, but the law of the Bible will not perish. Heaven and earth may pass away, but by no means the word of God will pass away. Matthew 24:35 says, mind you. Okay, don't challenge the word of God. And neither am I challenging the law of your land. Go ahead. If the law of your land approves you, if Caesar is approving, no problem. We are not here to rebel against Caesar. We are not here to rebel against anyone. We have no enemies. We tell you the truth, up to you. Noah said this, did the same thing. He spoke the truth, but the entire land rejected. What happened? Entire land perished. All the people of the land perished. The world perished. You want to be on the perishing side or you want to be on the living side? That you decide. Okay, fine. So it is by it. Coming back to the original point, fundamentalism, it's because of a certain belief. Yeah, a child believes playing is the only thing that I need to do until the age of 4 or 5. It believes firmly. The moment you shut the door or something like that, and it will start screaming, "Wah! Leave me outside!" Because playing is what I believe is the best thing to do and the only thing to do in life. But the same child, when it grows and crosses the age of 5 or 6 or even 10, and then it behaves like an adult almost. These days, 12-year-old children are behaving like adults. They know everything, man, almost. You see how things changes from age to age, from interval to interval, from generation to generation. For example, what generation existed in your bloodline 70 years ago, 80 years ago? They believed on certain things. Maybe they were not even Christians in my bloodline, I'm saying. But after that, another generation came and they believed on something else. And their children grew up in a different culture. And then another generation comes and they believe, no, no. What is the right belief that I should adopt or inherit? Is the question we are trying to answer, or we are answering actually, not trying to answer, we are answering from the Bible. I told you many times, Bible is the law book. Do not look at it as a book written for all the children, novel, comic kind of stories and all that. You know, stories are all evidences. Huh? These are all historical evidences. You need to learn something that really happened in people's life. There are parables. Jesus also has spoken fables to help you understand certain things which cannot be briefed through real-time incidents, which is also needed at times, right? But this is the book based on which you will be judged. Yes, you will be judged and judgment will be executed and justice will be given. Whether the justice or the verdict which is pronounced will take you to heaven or hell is in your hands. It's your free will. You make the decision. You make the choice. God doesn't make you the choice. Many, many Christians just don't get this point, you know. God willing, brother. Not God willing. Your will, brother. God will approve or God will reject. But I hope you understand God rejects. Therefore, you can reason yourself. If God rejects, that means he is displeased. Why is he displeased? Search the Bible. You will find your answer. And therefore, you can rectify your errors, repent and confess and reconcile with the Father and move on. You all understand what I'm saying? Most of the Christians don't understand. God willing, brother, let me see if I get a job or not. Brother, you need to try for a job. You need to work hard. You need to upgrade your skills. You need to really be sincere and loyal. You need to lower your standard if required. Some people always want to work as CEOs and CIOs and CTOs and always as brand ambassadors of India and all that. What? Not always you will get what you want. Sometimes you need to pick the job. What has been offered to you? I remember I worked for almost a year without salary. The whole year I got paid 11,500 rupees only. Whole year. And the previous earning, before that I worked in another company for 9 months and I have saved money. The saving habit I had always given to me from God. And I saved up money. I did not spend. I was not a spendthrift. A very good company. But all of a sudden, that company, I was a contractor. They said, you know, you can leave. No money to spend on contractors. Whatever I saved, I was able to manage that entire year. 11,500 rupees they gave me for the entire year. But did I give up that job? No, because that is a season where God will test me. He's taking me through that faith. He's building up my patience. Therefore, you see, what is making me to make that choice? The belief that I have that whatever God allows is for my good. You see, there is a belief which is allowing me to go through this impatience, long suffering, testing of faith and all that. Yet I came out victoriously. And I still remember that my money is over. All my savings are over. Then I had to catch a train, go to my parents and ask them, you know, could you please support me for this month? And they didn't know the story at all. I never told anything about my salary problems and all that. And they were surprised and they said, of course, you please take this money. And they supported me. And while coming back, I was really weeping in my heart. I said, God, I believe in you. I have faith in you. And that is what helped me to keep moving ahead. But I have nowhere to go. And that company shut down also. Sorry, I forgot to say that. That company shut down. And I was jobless for 2 weeks. And it is that time where I went out because I have to pay rent to my landlord. And I was staying in a little PG room, paying guest room. And then I came back. While coming back to Bangalore, I was weeping in the train. And I was asking God. At last, I had to go and borrow something from a human being. Even my parents are human beings. I'm not dependent on my parents. I'm dependent on you. But ultimately, you allow that also to make me more humble, maybe. Open up the door. You won't believe. On the way, something happened. And the next day, I received a call and I got another job. That was my third company. Three companies got shut down in a sequence. All right? That was my... No. That was my third company which got shut down. And that's where my money ran dry and this and that. And God gave me an opportunity after which the door was opened. No man could shut it down. No devil could shut it down. You understood, huh? God takes you through all sorts of experiences, but through it all, you are able to sail by the faith, because that faith is tightly coupled with a belief that in the name of Jesus, all things are possible. All my prayers will be answered. In Christ who strengthens me, I can do all things. If God for me, who can be against me? With men it is impossible, but with God all things are possible. I shall not be moved. His right hand will hold me. My feet will not slip. My feet will not dash against a stone. All the scriptures will be running in and through you. Psalm 62 verse number 2, Psalm 46:10, Psalms 91. Psalms 91, 15, 16, right? Philippians 4, 13, Matthew 19, 26. Some of the verses which I claimed just now, you know, all these verses. I don't memorize at all, right? It just stays in my heart, because why? That is the value of that belief. That's the power in that belief. When you believe in something, when you respect someone, right? You will not forget even the tiniest thing that they have done in your life, correct or not? But on the other hand, you don't respect someone, you don't even consider them as human beings, you just don't like them. Even the greatest things they would have done in your life, you don't remember. Why? Because you have disregarded, you don't like them, I have nothing to do with those people. Why? Because that is another belief. I don't have to consider what they have done in my life. That is also driven, biased by a belief. You're being biased, you're being pushed in a direction where you end up believing. You all understand the definition of fundamentalism. This is only our second session. That's why I'm spending little time helping you understand how fundamentalism is already playing a role in your life. It's not that yet to happen. It is already happening. And anything and everything, you turn around and look around the world, look around yourself. Look at the past, look at the present, look about the future. You just introspect the future. It is all going to be coupled to something called as fundamentalism. There is a belief system that is right inside you, that's behind you, that's pushing in you in a certain direction. But the million-dollar question you have to find an answer is whether that direction is leading you towards the kingdom of heaven or towards a destination, the lake of fire. Whether it is of God or it is of the devil. Whether it is from God or from the devil. That is where the scriptures are going to help us, shed light and grant us clarity. John 14, 16 and John 14, 26. Holy Spirit will be our helper and He will be briefing us, explaining us through the scriptures in a very convincing way that you know, yes, what I do is of God. It will be proven from the scriptures. But devil is also a master in confusing you from the scriptures through his misinterpretations. He's a master in that. He has done double PhD. Be very careful. Huh? That's how cult speakers and cult teachers and false prophets and false teachers, they evolved. And there are a lot of people, you will see a big cross in their church, Bible will be kept and all that. Anything and everything they preach has nothing to do with Bible. Yet you will see that those churches being called as mega churches, 10,000 members, 100,000 members, you see. A couple of churches here in Bangalore, and I had I myself got caught a couple of times for a few years. You won't believe. And it took me a few years to walk out of that deception. And because why? Deception itself is a very strong element. It's a very strong instrument, and the devil is a master in using that. He plays mind games. Which is the organ in your body he attacks first? Mind. Your brain, not your liver or kidney or heart. Those will function very well, don't worry. But the moment he attacks your mind and he captures your mind, obviously he knows using your mind how to make your kidney and liver fail. Lead your kidneys and livers towards failure or heart attacks. Why? He will make you alcoholic and he will justify from the Bible. See, Noah also drank, no. Lot also drank, no. Did they do it willingly? No, it just happens spontaneously. So like that, you know, you also drink and it just happens, you know. You're living in this world, what to do, full of temptations. One or two things here and there. Come on, you are only 40 years old. You have a long way, man. You can fix it after 60. You will be dead and gone in few years from then. Because why? Through your mind, he has captured your kidneys and livers and your family, your life. Everything is ruined. That's why you got to take care of your mind. On that evil day, you have to take care of these wiles of the devil. Romans 12 verses 1 and 2, you take and read. That's why Bible says, present your body as a living sacrifice and allow the Lord and the Holy Spirit to do His work in you. You know, this is also a belief. This must be the belief in which you should be operating your life, through which your life should be moving ahead. But except this, people have time for everything. Fundamentalism, by definition, the word fundamental can describe any religious impulse that adheres to his basic tenets. Tenets means basic descriptions or annotations or enunciations, right? Fundamentalism, for the purpose of this article, more than article, purpose of this session, is a movement within the church that holds to the basic essentials of the Christian faith. In other words, the purpose of fundamentalism can be described, it's the one which brings movement within the church. Fundamentalism is important, but which side of fundamentalism you are into, constructive or destructive, that's exactly what we are trying to classify and help you distinguish and discriminate. Therefore, you know where you belong. You cannot serve the mammon and God, the devil and God, in other words, the world, worldly pleasures, worldly related matters, all is of the devil. In modern times, no, the word fundamentalist is often used in a derogatory sense. Derogatory means in more of a, like a corporate terminology or a diplomat's language and something like that. But it is not only limited to those areas or those set of arena, you know. It can be extended, obviously. In fact, it was extracted from the Bible. Therefore, you have every right to classify yourself as what type of fundamentalist you are. And the fundamentalist movement or the fundamentalist movement has its roots in many of the theological colleges, the biblical colleges, everything they teach. You know, fundamentalist movement will hold its stand. You know, they give a lot of priority to that. Why? Because that's a basic foundational principle that everyone should be aware. You know, and that's exactly what Jesus had been talking for many years. Because why? What you believe? Believe. Without belief, you cannot please your God. Do you believe? Do you have faith? See, Jesus questions on the fundamentalism there. Which side of fundamentalism you belong? One boy's father, he told, right, you know, see what you can do and all that. And then Jesus would rebuke him. What? Are you challenging me that I can do this or not? Then he says, no, I'm sorry. Please give me that. Please pray for me that may I have faith and all that. And he was willing to move from the destructive side of fundamentalism to the constructive side of fundamentalism. And who gave him that thought? Jesus rebuked. Jesus turned around and rebuked him. Yes? And why we should consider is because of its strong association with the scriptures of the Bible, the promises of the Bible, the laws and commandments of the Bible. And history says that two wealthy church laymen commissioned 97 conservative church leaders from all over the Western world to write 12 volumes on the basic tenets of the Christian faith. And then they published these writings and distributed over 300,000 copies free of charge to ministers and others involved in the church leadership. And the books were entitled The Fundamentals. And they are still in printing today. Two volumes they have. You understand? The need and the essence, you know, how essential it is for every one of us to understand the basics of fundamentalism. And that's why I'm spending a long time in briefing you. And I'm telling you, whichever way you progress, you really, really need to understand it's fundamentalism that is right behind you, which is driving you in that direction. without a certain belief, without a certain faith, without something you have learned from your forefathers in which you believe, is not, you know, without all this is not how you are moving ahead. All these are the reasons that are behind you marching ahead in certain direction. That includes your habitual practices, your principles that you believe, your habits, your behavioral pattern, your mannerism, your conduct, your faith levels, your spiritual system, the health of your spiritual system. All these are tightly coupled to this strong term called as fundamentalism. What you believe. All right, I would like to end this session here and we will continue from our next session. We're still in the basics of fundamentalism. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this wonderful time, opportunity that you've given to all of us, that we are able to read and meditate from the Word of God. And we are reviewing a very, very important doctrine, very important subject, fundamentalism. Please brief us, admonish us, illustrate us. In Jesus' name we pray. God bless you. Please subscribe if you have not. You will start receiving automatic notifications and share these channel details, the videos you watch with whomever you know. That helps them also to walk in the life of salvation. According to Colossians 4:3, there is a commandment that you have to pray for all the ministers of God. Therefore, pray for all evangelists, missionaries, pastors, and false prophets, false teachers. May they repent and come back to God. And that also means, please remember our ministries too. Please remember me. And likewise, you have a prayer request. You don't have to run to any human beings. It's enough that you go to Jesus. And Abba Father is there to receive all your petitions and perfect your concerns. But then again, you should have that belief. When you pray, believe you have received it. Matthew 21:22 says that. Matthew 6:5, 6, Matthew 7:7, ask you shall be receiving it. Seek you will find. Matthew 19:26, with men it is impossible, but with God all things are possible. Philippians 4:6, you know, pray without anxiety, but make your request known to God with thanksgiving and prayer in the name of Jesus. John 14:14, Psalms 138 verse 8. You read all these verses, right? These will lay down the principles of prayer, and that will also tell you that these are nothing but, you know, the nomenclatures of fundamentalism, the attributes of fundamentalism. See, your petitions are being answered because you believe in these scriptures. You believe in what has been written. God bless you. Take care. I will meet you soon.